these media programs. We've had a very long-standing work in really briefing media. I mean, it actually started off, if you think about it, as old as when CSE started in 1980s. Anil started this work. And the aim was, as a journalist himself, he realized that one of the things that we don't have, most of us don't have the privilege of doing, is getting in-depth knowledge into any one issue. But also, it's very clear that most of us are driven by deadlines, and you're finishing one story and you're moving to another. And so the question is, how can you do this in a way that it's packaged tightly, conveniently, and yet gives you all the information that you require? And that's really been the effort that we've had. Shuparno and Papia, who Shuparno leads this work and Papia works on this with him, they have now been running fellowships for which number? Fellowship are you on now? 13. Tiger. But you've already announced the next one. Four more you have announced, okay. So the idea was that we should make this complementary. We have fellowships. Fellowships are essentially ways in which we provide, it's very nominal amount of money, travel money, some amount of money, which allows journalists to travel, to write about issues. But then we found that it was also important to back it up with a workshop which helped you to explore different issues. Now, we've tried to do this always at the beginning of the fellowship, but it never happens. With all our crazy schedules, the ideal thing should be when you announce a fellowship, you also have the briefing workshop, so that it sort of helps the journalists, all of us, write better, to look at different issues better. But it never ever happens, even though we've always tried to do so. The last such meeting we had was in Andhra Pradesh, Vishakhapatnam, where we looked at that very fascinating issue of the conflicts over water that are emerging between industry and water bodies. And I must say that post that, I have seen some very interesting writing coming out of it. A lot of new ideas emerged in that workshop. And that was, we went to Sompeta after that to look at, not Sompeta, we went to Bakrapali to look at the whole conflict over land, over water and water bodies, over the thermal power project. This meeting has been long in the making, and we are sorry that we've had to change dates and we've had to change programs. We are really sorry, but it's really been Shuparno and Papia's persistence that this meeting has actually happened, not because of that issue. And yes, Mr. Negi is there, but we don't give you any credit for this meeting happening, Negi ji. We have chased and chased and chased and reworked our programs accordingly, because we understand that you're very busy. This is a tough time right now, but nevertheless, I have to give full credit to this, to Shuparno and Papia, for bringing us together for doing this. Now, the program is as follows. We will have a brief overview this morning on the issues, which Rajeshji and I will do. Then we have the afternoon session, which I think is a very important session on the whole conflict between people and tigers, and looking at some sort of what is the way ahead, what can be done about it. Shankar is not coming, but Ghazala is there, Mr. Chauhan is there, Ravi I can see, Madhu I can see. Then the whole issue of tourism has become a very, very big issue in tiger reserves, and we thought a separate session on that would be very important to do. We have asked Mr. Panjwani, who is in fact the amicus in the Supreme Court right now, helping the court. The court has a matter which we will hear about from him, which has come out of Madhya Pradesh, and the court is taking a decision whether tourism should be allowed at all in core areas of tiger reserves or not. And he is the amicus in that case. We also have a very important group from Bangalore, Equations, which has been working on the whole issue of tourism and ecotourism for a very, very long time. Because, again, the idea being, if you want tourism, then in what conditions and how and who should it benefit? And all those questions need to be discussed now. We then have a session looking at the science of the census of tigers. Again, very important. I mean, we're talking about, I mean, if many of you remember when Sariska started, when the whole scandal or issue came up about Sariska, where we suddenly discovered there were no tigers, one of the biggest issues there was that how were we getting our estimation so wrong? How did we not realize that there were no tigers in Sariska? What were we doing wrong? And that was a stage when the Tiger Task Force was set up, when Rajesh Ji and we worked very closely together to actually see what could be a new estimation methodology. How could you estimate numbers better? And obviously that whole area, I think, has really grown in the last 2-3 years, and we look forward to hearing from, we have not been able to get Rajesh Ji, anyone from Wildlife Institute, because Dr. Chala is on leave and Kamal was not able to come, but we're hoping he will fit in and give us a good idea of what's happening. But I think that's going to be important for us to learn, because clearly in each one of our regions, that's a very big area. And then to look at the whole issue of wildlife crime. And there again, there's been some developments, some not. So we'll learn about that. And tomorrow there's the trip to court. I've got a call from the director. In 2005, I'm not a tiger specialist. In fact, Rajesh Ji will remember when I was appointed the chairman of the Tiger Task Force, I was accused of there was a lot of public anger about it, and one of the things was that I had never seen a tiger in my life. And so how could I be appointed as a tiger, as the head of the Tiger Task Force? Of course, Rajesh Ji made sure that by the end of the Tiger Task Force report, I had seen about 14 tigers. So nobody can now say that I'm not a tiger expert. If that is the hallmark of a tiger expert, is that you have to see a tiger, then I have seen a tiger, okay? So, but when we were asked to put this report together, it was a very strange circumstance. I think there was a huge amount of shock in the country that suddenly we found that tigers had disappeared from Sariska. Obviously, this was not acceptable. Obviously, the question was, what can we do about it? And the Prime Minister's office set up a task force, which was interestingly, I think, created in a way that we could get maximum voices in. We also made sure that we did a lot of work to learn what was happening in the country. We took exactly 3 months over this report. So as people will accuse me, I'm an instant expert. I'm an expert who did everything, learned everything in 3 months. But I had an amazing fortune of listening and hearing from people across the country. We traveled to 3 or 4 parts of the country. We met, we organized meetings in different parts. We understood what the challenges were. And our attempt was in the report to put forward an agenda of what needs to be done. So when I'm looking at it today, you need to see what happened in 2005, the report. Whether the agenda was correct or not, what needed to be done further, and what has been done today. And I think that's really the big issue that I would suggest that we need to focus on, because reinventing the wheel is something that we Indians are very good at. We always want to start off right at the first word of what's a tiger. But I think what would be important to do is to really say, obviously no report can be final, no report can be perfect, no report can have all the right recommendations. So the question then becomes, what more can we do, how more can we do it, where are we failing? If you look at the recommendations made by the task force, the first recommendation recommendation was about the institutional strengthening of the affairs of who was managing tigers. We essentially proposed that there should be a statutory authority which should be created, which would have much more autonomy, which could take decisions about matters to do with tigers. Before the report was done, Rajeshji, we just had a tiger scheme. And so the idea was that let's strengthen the institution for decision making. Clearly that is an area which I think is probably, that work was done. We did manage to get a bill in, we managed to get the authority created. But I'm sure Rajeshji and all of us will learn that there is still that work half completed. There's probably a lot more work to be done. But clearly the first thing in my view always is, what are the institutional mechanisms for better decision making? And that's going to be one very important issue also for the future. The second very contentious issue when we were doing the report was this issue of a tiger census. At that time, the only methodology which was being used in the country was a pug mark methodology, where people really looked at pug marks and over time, and I'm told that methodology was actually a very good methodology when it started off, but over time it deteriorated, where the same pug mark of the same tiger was counted 5 times. And various things like that started happening. And so there was a lot of talk about a new methodology. Now, taking decisions on science in this country are the most difficult ones, because no two scientists ever agree on what needs to be done. And I think the biggest gain out of this Tiger Task Force report was that for whatever it is worth, we brought a consensus together and said, this is the methodology with which we begin a new way of estimating tiger population. In the report we said, this is not the final methodology. You can keep improving it, you should keep improving it, you should keep working out where can we do more careful estimation. But we said this could be the first such methodology. And I think that was a big change, Rajeshji, and that happened right away after the report, then you managed to get the first census done. We also recommended that there should be a crime bureau, wildlife crime bureau, and that we should rework the Wildlife Protection Act for faster conviction of offenders. This work was also done. I don't know, I think Papia and Shubhano will tell us, they have been trying desperately to get hold of the new person who has come in charge of the Wildlife Crime Bureau. I don't think they've managed to reach him. Who's come, Mr. Maybe?
In fact, there's one police officer, Mr. Negi. He's in charge right now.
I know we've been trying to get someone to come and brief you because we wanted to get an idea. This crime bureau is now 4 years old, if I remember right. And I think we should get a good briefing about what's happening on the crime bureau. And especially for many of you who come from Bhopal, who come from Nagpur and others, I mean, in Madhya Pradesh, they're supposed to be really major areas of wildlife crime. So it would be good to know what is happening with the crime bureau. We will still push for it. I think we have not been able, because there's a change of guard happening. Rima has left and somebody else has to be appointed. We also said that there needs to be protection in the reserve that needs to be improved. And more importantly, in our report, we had looked at the fact that we needed a desperate, there was a huge effort that was needed to fill vacancies of guards. But we said very clearly that guards must be from local people. So we said that you need to prioritize, in fact, you need to make sure that local people get appointed as guards in the tiger reserves. We also, there was a big fight when, and you know, given the fact that I was accused of being a non-tiger wala, there was a big fight that continues to happen, and I know that it will happen today as well, which is good. I think we need to keep discussing it. There was a big fight happening about whether you needed to do relocation at all of local people from the tiger reserves or not. whether you needed to do, whether you could actually plan on villagers to live within the reserves forever. The Tiger Task Force took a very, very nuanced opinion about this. Some accused us, both sides accused us of getting it wrong. The tribal groups as well as the tiger group. But our position was as follows. Our position was that you need to do very careful relocation of a certain number of villagers from the tiger reserves. You need to do it keeping in mind that you don't have the capacity to relocate everybody. You also need to do it keeping in mind that you don't have the money to do proper relocation. And we also suggested that there needs to be an enhanced package for relocation. We also suggested that you need to be able to make people better off after they are relocated from tiger reserves. But we did agree that there needs to be a certain amount of relocation from the tiger reserves. But simultaneously, we also said that you will never be able to relocate everybody from tiger reserves. So you need a coexistence package as well. You need to be able to find ways in which local people can live with within the reserves, close to the reserves, and yet we do not end up with destroying the tiger reserves. So in that, we had suggested a very clear strategy, and frankly, this is an area which I think, Rajeshji, we need to work a lot more on. We need a strategy to actually make buffer zones, areas in which people benefit from buffer zones as well. Today, what is happening is that the tiger reserves are protected, and all the areas around the tiger reserves become no development zones. And people who live there get absolutely no help to be able to benefit from the fact that they live in buffer zones. And so there is enormous anger between the tiger and local people, and that clearly needs to be done. And then our last point, which has become a very hot issue now, 5 years, 6 years later, is to benefit, strategies for tourism which will benefit both conservation but also people. So our 7 main recommendations were as follows. We did a lot of data analysis. This was one tiger report which had no photograph of a tiger. Okay? It was very strange because all tiger reports basically are based on the beauty and the magnificence of the animal, and they essentially make you believe that the only way you can protect it is by, you know, just believing in beauty. Whereas what we believed in is that you needed to get your data right, you needed to get your information right, you needed to get a state of art prepared so that you could actually take some very hard decisions. We looked at, you know, we did a whole lot of calculations, and some interesting calculations we did was to look at allocation of funds to tiger reserves per square kilometers. We also looked, actually, I don't have that table here, but we also looked at how much was spent per tiger. And what was interesting was that there were, in tiger reserves, obviously this is not a scientific way because you could have very low density tiger reserves, you still need to spend a lot. But it's really ironic when Sariska becomes the top reserve on which you've been spending. And so clearly there were issues there to ask that why are you getting your strategies wrong? And a lot of things were done because of that to say how would you get reportage from the tiger reserves, which would help us to understand what's happening to the health of the reserve and health of the tigers. We also assessed infrastructure spending. We looked at how much area is covered by each camp. We looked at what is the national average. We looked at what needs to be done to improve protection within a tiger reserve. We looked at the average age of frontline staff. At that point, it was 42 years. And I'm sure, Rajeshji, now if you do it, it will be about 50 years, right?
But many states are
I saw that. But there's a lot of new recruitment that is happening as well, which is very good. But at that time, clearly, one of the areas that had come up was that you had a real crisis with frontline staff. And frontline staff also, we looked at all the fact that we needed to make sure that they had better facilities. We also, as we said, we assessed vacancies, and we made a very clear recommendation, which is actually not being followed today, where we said that only local people should be hired. Because most states are hiring guards today based on the state recruitment strategy. So they have one examination for all recruitment that happens. I was in Madhya Pradesh recently and I found that the guards in tiger reserves are MPhils, are PhDs, are essentially people who don't want to be a forest guard. And they have become a forest guard only because there's a statewide exam. And given the sheer desperation of jobs in this country, they qualify. But clearly, that's not going to make our strategies for forest protection and tiger protection better. But in terms of our overall assessment, we said that one of our most, you know, if you look at our most hard-hitting assessment was that our tiger reserves today are islands of conservation under threat. We were asked to give a verdict whether every tiger reserve was as bad as Sariska, and we said no. But we said that whatever protection of tigers is happening today, it's happening against all odds. And there are two levels of threats. There's a threat from outside pressure, which is mining, hydroelectric plants, roads and poaching. But there's also a siege from within, which is that people who have been denied the benefits of conservation, people who live in these tiger reserves, who have never been compensated for their livelihood, for the loss of their livelihoods, are waging a war as well. So there is a war within, there's a war on conservation, and our assessment was that we are losing it bit by bit, tiger, and there's a war between tiger and people. We had put out this map at that stage, and this map has actually meant a whole area of research in CSC. I mean, it's been amazing for us that when we did this, Rajesh Ji, we did this map in 2005 for tigers, where we essentially mapped the forest area, we mapped the poorest districts of India, and we mapped where the tigers lived. And we said that the irony of the situation is that the poor of India live in what we would call its richest lands. And that this is an indictment of the way we do development, it's an indictment of the way we do conservation. But interestingly for CSC, this map has actually grown and grown and grown, because after this report, we started working on mining. And in mining report, we actually extended it, and when we put in the mineral resources, it became an even bigger match. And then while we were doing the mining report, we also looked at naxalism. And that became an even bigger match. So now it is a match between the tigers of India, the forests of India, the water of India, the minerals of India, the poverty of India, and the maximum unrest in India. So it's really been a map which actually, I mean, in 2005 when we did this, this is the first time we plotted it. But since then, our understanding has grown, and it has only grown to say that the crisis actually is of all natural resources. And the point that we made even then, and the point I constantly make today when it comes to forests, is that we have to get our forest management strategies right. We have gone in this country from a process where there was huge, wide-scale extraction, and we were extracting forests at throwaway prices for anywhere, for paper mills, for everything else, to a period where there is protection, where the state and the private sector has taken control, very largely the state has taken control for conservation. But in both cases, we have excluded people. And the big challenge today is that whether it is in sustainable harvesting or whether it is in conservation, how can you include people into forests? And that is the core agenda of forestry, which we still have not got right. And to my mind, that's really the big issue for the future. And the reason is that unlike any other part of the world, our forests are habitat of people. Our forests are not wilderness areas. Everywhere in the world where we have borrowed our forest science from, they call forest wilderness. But in India, there is no wilderness. I mean, I have not gone to a part of India where I have not seen some amount of grazing, some amount of human pressure. There is, our forests are habitats of people. Large numbers of people depend on forests for livelihood. Forests are survival base of the poorest. And therefore, the complexity in India, which is different perhaps from Australia and certainly from the US, is that management and use will demand cooperation. Exclusion of people cannot and will not work. And that is the fundamental principle with which I think we need to reorient both conservation and also forestry management. You have to secure the interests of the poor with the interests of forests. And more importantly now, with the interests of conservation. Otherwise, you're in a vicious cycle where the poor have no option but to use forests. Their use is termed as illegal users. And this in turn exacerbates poverty and makes conservation impossible. In our report, one of the things that really taught me when we were looking at it was this map of Sariska. It was fascinating for me because it sort of brought the whole picture of forests and tigers together. The fact is today there's a double jeopardy for tigers. Tigers are territorial animals, as I was taught by Rajesh Chi and Negi Ji. You were in Tana, right, when we came and visited it. We looked at it, and it was, tigers are territorial animals, they have to move out, but they can't because the forests outside have disappeared. And yet, because the forests outside have disappeared, people have to move in for getting their basic material. So you literally have a situation of this double jeopardy for tigers that exists. So as I said, we said that three things: expand the inviolate space for tigers by minimizing human pressure, repair the relationship with people who share the tiger's habitat by building strategies for coexistence, and thirdly, most importantly, which is still not happening at all today, is that regenerate forest habitats in the fringes of protected enclaves by investing in forest, water, and grassland economies of the people. The most important and the operative word here is economies, local economies of the people. That if you do not do this, your forests will not get regenerated and you will never be able to secure the larger home of the tiger, which you need to do. So the first agenda in which we had given a lot of data was one, as I said, creating inviolate spaces. This was a very, very difficult decision to be taken. There was a lot of people who wanted complete inviolate space, there were a lot of people who wanted none of it. We as a group took somewhere in between path, and we basically argued that the government had over the last 30 years only relocated 80 villages in 30 years. And we had a very poor track record in relocation. And so if you really wanted to relocate, you needed to prioritize relocation and you needed to improve it.
Or
30 was across the country. 80 villages were across the country. Across the country. In 30 years.
Up to 2005,
our figures were that we had relocated only 80 villages, of which quite a few had even come back, Rajeshji, at that time.
Sariska
and also Kuno. One village had come back at that time. 2005 or so. Oh, whatever. The point was a very small amount of relocation had happened. And our assessment was that there were 273 villages in core area. This was a quick assessment we had done, and you can give us better figures, I'm sure, now, Rajeshji. We had said, however, if you looked at all the tiger reserves, there were as many as 1,500 villages. Now, when our basic point to government was that, listen, if in 30 years you've relocated 80 villages, then please understand that your capacity to relocate is limited. And so if there are 1,500 villages, you cannot relocate all of them. You need to prioritize. And we also said that there is a cost to that relocation. We had given the estimations. And we had said that there is also a question of feasibility. Because one of the biggest tragedies of relocation has been that when you relocate people from inside the tiger reserves, you invariably relocate them on forest land which is outside the tiger reserve. Okay? There is no, these lands are not capable of doing agriculture. They're normally the fringe of the same park. People are forest dependent. They need access to grazing land, fuel wood, fodder, minor forest, because that's all they know. Okay? And so, because you have not thought about relocation carefully, and you have not provided for livelihood support, people have no alternative but to depend back on the same forest. We had also said very clearly that in most of the relocation, when people were being given land, they were still given forest land with no rights to be able to sell it, no rights to be able to do much with it. So we said that those things need to change. I mean, my biggest learning came from Ranthambore, where I went to a very, very poor village inside Ranthambore. And my question to them was, why do you want to live in this hell of a place? I mean, every day you have fights with the tiger, with the forest guards. Every day your cattle is taken away by tigers. Every day you have a problem. You're basically no schools, nothing over there. You live a very, very poor existence. And I don't know if Rajeshji remembers this, but everybody, our full task force was there at that time. And the people looked at us in our face and said to us, listen, we are poor. But the village next to us, which was relocated and was taken to that place, they're even poorer than us. So unless you do this properly, there is going to be no interest in people to move out, and they should not be an interest. And then, of course, there's a whole issue of the rights of people to the forest and the rights that need to be settled. So we had said, identify villages that need to be relocated very carefully. Look at it from a point of view of conservation. Do time-bound voluntary relocation. Give facilities, improve conditions. And we had said, change the land use of the relocated land if it is forest. So people actually have rights over the land that they get. And the bottom line of what we had said to government was, if you want to do relocation and if you want this to succeed, do not increase poverty. Do not intensify the antagonism against conservation. Do not make people enemies of the tiger. And that was something that we had said. We had also said that you cannot relocate all. So please think about how you can work with people. We had also made a very strong statement in the report, which had got us a lot of criticism. We had said not every use by local people is against conservation. It is not as if people who live within the park are enemies of the park, or by their very nature of living will destroy the park. We need to understand what use can be supported, what use can be built, what use can actually be worked upon. We also have to think about the fact that whereas the use by the poor is intensive, the use by industry is very extensive. So if you really want your parks to remain, then the only way they'll remain is people become protectors of the park. Because if they don't, then let's be very clear, when the miners get in and the thermal power plants get in, then no park will remain. So the use by the rich is much more extensive than the use by the rich. We had also at that stage, and this was obviously a lot has happened in this area, not enough has happened, but I think the groups who work on tribal rights have made their point very, very strongly as well, and I think that's been very much part of the balance that exists, where there has been a whole issue about how local people's rights have been taken away, have not been settled, people were not compensated, but relocated. And people were made trespassers in their own land. And we basically said that whereas the Act says that the rights cannot be taken away if alternative fuel, fodder, forest produce is not provided, as we know at some point, based on the Supreme Court judgment, all rights were expunged by the MOEF. And no alternative was provided. And as a result of it, people's hostility grew, conflict has grown, and illegal use grew. So we basically asked for inclusive conservation as a must in the future. We did not know what inclusive conservation means, and quite honestly, we still don't know. It's a word, but it needs to be tried out. if we don't even try out what it will mean, I don't think we'll be able to progress. And we essentially had said, redesign conservation to do collaborative management. Now you could have a range of options. You could do employment. You could say all employment in a tiger reserve will come from local people, and you will guarantee that, and you will make sure that that happens. You could make sure that there is tourism benefits. You could give rights over sustainable harvesting. You could move towards collaborative management or control. So there could be a range of issues, ways in which you could do this, but you needed to experiment. You needed to change the conservation paradigm. Our second agenda was very clearly, and this is something that I think needs to be understood more and more, was when we put this data together, it's very, very rough, but you will see one of the most interesting things was that every census, and remember this is old census, this is still the Pugmark census, but for whatever it is worth, every census showed that half the tigers actually were outside the tiger reserves. And therefore, the big issue was that you needed to protect the forests, which were the habitats of tigers. But we were also clear that you cannot protect forests without the involvement of people. You cannot protect forests without creating forest-based livelihoods. Meena was in Gadchiroli when we did the bamboo issue. I mean, that has been resisted by foresters tooth and nail, and even now, they refuse to give local people the rights to grow and harvest bamboo. Even though we managed to get bamboo sort of created as a grass, now the foresters are saying, Jairam Ramesh wrote a letter, we don't care, we don't even know who Jairam Ramesh is, he was a minister at some point, he's no longer a minister, we will not recognize any of his writings, these are not notifications, change the law if you want bamboo to be called a grass. And in Gadchiroli, the foresters have teamed up with Balarpur paper to get the Naxalites on the backs of people who want the rights to harvest bamboo. So let's be very, very clear. There are big stakes over here, and there are big issues over here, but unless you sort them out, let's also be clear. Your forests are not going to be unless people have rights over it and people can benefit economically from forest conservation. This was the map that actually taught me everything. I mean, just look at this. Every reserve we go to it separately. We think of Kanha separately from Palamu, from Bandhavgarh, from Panna to Satpura. And yet these were all completely contiguous within a forest future. Now, unless you can actually protect the forests of that region, you will make each one of those parks into magnified zoos. That is slightly bigger than a city zoo, but they're a zoo. And that's really the biggest challenge that we have still, that we have not been able to enjoin the future of the tiger to forest conservation, forest protection. And we've not been able to do that because we have not considered how people will be involved in forests. We also looked at how many people live in the fringe of forests, and there were huge numbers on the fringe of forests more than inside. And these are the same people who use the forest resources intensively. They have a major challenge where the tiger comes into their home, the animals come into their home, destroy their crops, destroy their fields. They suffer from loss of their livestock. And today, these people do not want the tiger in their land, yet they also see that everything is being done for the tiger and not for them. So there is huge antagonism, and I mean, I hope that we'll be able to find ways much more creatively than we have to expand the safe space for tigers to roam. In my assessment and further to our work also in 2005, I think we need a serious relook at what we call the buffer of a tiger reserve. Today, the buffer of a tiger reserve literally means a no development zone. People get no benefits from it. Yet, you need to find ways that people can gain from conservation. People should want to live in buffer of a tiger reserve. Why can't we give money for enhanced development of these buffer areas, but that development comes only in forests and forest-based livelihoods? You need to think about sharing the share of tourism in these buffer reserves. But the bottom line being that people who live around a tiger reserve must feel that they will benefit from it as well. The third big agenda that we had raised at that time, and I have to tell you, this was the trickiest of all agendas. This was the really nasty one. It got me particularly a huge amount of flack. Rajesh, a lot of flack I got for this agenda on tourism. Essentially, the argument that we had made at that time was that this is a double-edged sword. It can benefit parks, it can benefit tigers, it can benefit people. But it can also be very destructive because of number, pressure, hotels on the park edge, and which are not compatible with conservation. Tomorrow when you go to Corbett, one of the reasons we chose Corbett is the tourism that is happening all around the park. It's very important to understand. What is the impact of that on the park itself? We had looked at Ranthambore and we had said that in fact what you are having today is huge amount of tourism which benefits fairly rich hotels. We had calculated in 2005 an annual turnover of 22 crore from the 21 hotels that existed. If you look at it, 30 crores had been spent on Ranthambore as public financing over a period of about 30 years. And the annual turnover of these hotels was equivalent to all the public investment that was happening. And yet there was absolutely no benefit that people, local people were getting because of the hotels that were created. At most, and we tried to get data on how many people were employed as sweepers, as waiters, as guards, because that's really all that hotels say. But even that data was not forthcoming because they were very high-end hotels, most of them, and they needed to have skilled personnel. And so as a result of it, people's anger grows and they see more and more tourism growing, people being shifted out, and hotels shifting. And in fact, I have to say, Rajesh Ji has been doing a lot to try and reverse this. And I think you will be under a lot of pressure in the next few months as there is now an attempt to do a new tourism policy, an ecotourism policy for tiger reserves. The policy was put on the website last year, Rajesh Ji?
Last June.
One of the elements of the policy was that we need to correct this injustice that is happening. We also need to find ways in which we can manage tourism better in the core areas of tiger reserves. The government set up a committee to look into the policy. I was a member of the committee as well. The report has now been submitted to the government to finalize that policy. So I think one of the things we should find out with IHG is what's happening to that. Okay. And we had at that stage recommended a 3 kilometer from boundary for homestead tourism. We had also said a cess should be paid by hotels, which actually goes towards the park. And we had also said that gate receipts must be fully returned to the park, and they should be shared between people in the park. And so the essential point that we had made in 2005, a lot of it, some of it has been implemented, some of it still needs to be implemented, is that change the paradigm of conservation. Find a way in which you can actually live, you can build conservation in a way that people who live in and around the habitat of the tiger are not dispossessed, are not made trespassers in their own land, are not made even poorer than where they are today. Find a model of conservation, perhaps it doesn't exist anywhere in the world at the scale we need to implement it, but find a model of conservation in which you can actually do conservation in a way that benefits local communities and benefits, obviously, the tiger. But conservation must have that dual purpose. And we had said that is absolutely our imperative. Now that's really where, in some senses, this debate stands even today. A lot of work has happened, and maybe Rajesh, you can bring us up to speed at some of the things that you have been doing over the last few years. Thank you.